rare and controversial topics of apline infertility. Many of the times when women has recurrent pregnancy losses and bad obstetric history, they're referred to us for an opinion on whether the APLA or the autoimmunity affects the affects the infertility part or the fertility part or not. It's more of a reassurance we give because we would not interfere with the treatment of the obstetrics. So unless and until a woman has some other fertility issues, wherein in this lady could have been a tubal factor to be evaluated, we don't interfere. We interfere when there is a need for a fertility treatment from some aspect of ovarian reserves or some aspect of the tubal factor or the male factor or the uterine factors. Now, what is the exact role of apline infertility is a big controversy to see for. So there is a beautiful saying, all the flowers of tomorrow are in the seeds of today. When we come, and it is very true in reproductive medicine because it is the well-being and the microenvironment of the mother's womb, which plays a very important role for implantation and to nurture the baby for 9 months in the womb and have a healthy offspring. So when we start with implantation is characterized by interaction of two immunologically and genetically distinct tissues. During implantation, local and systemic immune factors, cytokines and growth factors may interact with addition molecules and other matrix-associated proteins, glycoproteins and peptide. So this is where immunology may play a role in implantation. We all know that pregnancy is an immunocompromised state and it has to be for a different genetic composition to nurture for 9 months. And when autoimmunity strikes, it is a turbulent pregnancy as we all know. Autoantibodies such as anti-cardiolipin antibodies, as Madam has said, anti-nuclear antibodies have shown to be associated with obstetric complications. Autoantibodies have also been implicated as one of the possible causes of IVF failure and unexplained infertility. So how does this work? The autoantibodies affect the clotting cascade of the system. In addition to the classic thrombotic mechanisms, there is residual vessel thrombosis, complement activation, reduction of annexin 5, leading to placental tissue damage and ultimately resulting in abortion. Now, how does the clotting cascade gets affected because of the inhibition of prostacyclines, increased platelet activation, decreased activation of antithrombotic action of the placental vessels, resulting in thrombosis of placental vessels, resulting in placental insufficiency. There is recent evidence that direct binding of APAs to the trophoblast may inhibit the syncytio, that is cyto to syncytio conversion and trophoblast invasion, HCG production and implantation. So when such women come to us, they anticipate that there would be some implantation failures which is not leading for the implantation to occur or causing a early pregnancy failure. So we all know that trophoblastic invasion is a very important part in implantation. This part is very important because it has to form the placental sinuses, which is very important in fetal-maternal circulation, as we all know. So what happens when this gets affected? So when this gets affected, because of accumulation of foam cells, fibrinoid necrosis, perivascular inflammatory cell infiltration, there is decidual vasculopathy, which causes placental insufficiency. Here you can see that the antiphospholipid antibodies induce placental thrombosis and they directly react with the trophoblast, interfering with the invasion and implantation. So now when it comes to implantation failure, there are various reasons from implantation failure, from the interplay of cytokines to the genetic composition of the embryo itself, to the receptivity window, to the receptivity of the endometrium and so on and so forth. So but when the most important thing in implantation we know is invasion of the trophoectoderm or the trophoblast into the maternal endometrium and causing decidualization. So as APLA can affect trophoblastic invasion and uterine decidualization, it was hypothesized that antibodies could act before the pregnancy was detected. However, this theory was never confirmed. Now, why I am discussing this is the first question to us as a fertility specialist is, what is the role of autoimmunity in infertility? And here I'm going to discuss only that. I'm going to lay some facts straight today from data. So with this hypothesis in mind, Dr. Norbert Gleischer, he is known for his research in reproductive medicine and has more than 165 papers to his accord, came up with the first concept of reproductive autoimmune failure syndrome, which is called as RAFS. Now, abnormal autoimmune function in clinically asymptomatic patients can lead to reproductive failure, has led us to define the reproductive autoimmune failure syndrome as a diagnostic entity. There is a woman's need for increased self-tolerance in the face of antigenic exposure to the maternal haplotype of the fetus during normal pregnancy. Abnormal autoimmune function may lead to reproductive failure at different stages of reproductive process, depending upon the quality and possible quantity of the abnormal autoimmune response. So it's the titers of the antibodies which may also be important. So after this, after few years, Elijewa came up with a study of 21 IVF failures with biochemical pregnancies. And they said that autoimmunity may play a role in implantation failure in IVF-ET. Circulating autoantibodies should be screened for and is therefore recommended after chemical pregnancy. The same group did a review published in Fertility Sterility 1997 saying that when there is abnormal autoantibody levels are present in the woman with reproductive failure, the reproductive failure alone should be considered as one of the possible clinical expression of autoimmune disorder. There were two relevant questions after this. Whether the patient should be treated for autoimmunity, and that still remains unsolved. And the second was a prospective placebo control trial should be done. So what, in the same year, Caroline studied 312 implantation failures with 100 controls. And they found that they studied the 7 antibody panel, as Dr. Sujata said, we cannot study all of them, but phosphatidyl, glycerin and sarin are slightly known to have some effect with the implantation. So they said that a complete APA panel using 7 isotopes is necessary for diagnosing implantation failure associated with RAFs. If only an ACA is measured, 4% of the positive APAs are detected and 81% would be missed. With this, the diagnosis of autoimmune, reproductive autoimmune failure as an entity came. But how do we go ahead with the diagnostic concepts, the molecular testing, the empirical treatment which is given to all?